Okay, so I think I'm audible. Can I proceed?
Yes.
Okay, so we'll be talking about some of the vaccines which were not covered yesterday. This is with regards to, it will not be all exhaustive. Just to tell you a few points, like as what will be asked for postgraduates in their Vaigav OC. So first we'll see about BCG. So the BCG is the only effective vaccine available against tuberculosis as of date. So it is one of the oldest vaccines. It's been in use for almost a century, from 1921 to 2021 now. And it was developed by joint effort of French microbiologist Albert Calmette and veterinary surgeon Camille Gurin. It's a live vaccine. It is supplied as a lyophilized freeze-dried powder in a vacuum-sealed multi-dose amber-colored ampules or a 2 ml vials. It is to be diluted with a diluent given or with sterile NS. After reconstitution, it has to be stored at 2 to 8 degree, protected from light, and this way it can be stored for 4 to 6 hours. If kept for, it does not have any added antimicrobial to it. So if you are going to keep it for a longer time, there is risk of toxic shock syndrome. It has to be kept after reconstitution only for 4 to 6 hours. And it is administered 0.05 ml intradermally. If it is given in the correct technique, it will raise a wheel of it will raise a wheel of 5 millimeter. It is given in the lateral aspect of the left upper arm in the deltoid. So what is the reaction you expect? Initially you don't expect any reaction except for a wheel of 5 millimeter immediately. So after 2 to 3 weeks you start getting a papule, and this papule becomes around 4 to 8 millimeter size in 5 to 6 weeks, and the scar develops in 6 to 12 weeks. And we have to remember that 10% of children who are administered BCG do not develop any scar. So if a person doesn't have scar, it doesn't mean that it is not taken up. And this is quite efficacious. Against pulmonary tuberculosis, the efficacy is around 59%. Against severe tuberculosis, it is 85%. Against TBM, it is 73% efficacious. And against miliary TB, it has got 77% efficacy. So what are the adverse events you encounter with this BCG? So BCG adenitis is a common thing which is encountered, but mostly it is due to wrong technique, not giving it intradermally, rather giving it subdermally or subcutaneously. And this BCG adenitis is seen in almost 6 out of 1,000 patients who are injected. And another but most important complication is disseminated BCGosis. The incidence is less common. It is only around 1 to 4 cases per million children injected. But the significance is that it has got a high case fatality ratio. It has got a very high mortality. And this occurs mainly in immunodeficient. The problem is the policy is universal neonatal BCG administration. So you give BCG as soon as a baby is born. So we don't get to know who are the ones who are going to develop immunodeficiency later. So we don't anticipate and we give BCG for all children. But one to four among a million can develop this if they have SCID or something like that. So if the person, a baby, is going to have a family history of SCID or due to any reason, if you're going to suspect immunodeficiency in a newborn, better postpone giving BCG till you are sure that the child does not have any immunodeficiency. And special situations, if a baby is born to mother with pulmonary tuberculosis, you don't give BCGs right away. You give INH for 6 months, and at the end of 6 months, you give BCG. No need for Manto testing. You can right away give the BCG. And for a HIV positive infant, generally, if symptom is going to be asymptomatic, child is going to be asymptomatic, you can give. Only if an asymptomatic child, BCG is preferred, though it's a live vaccine. And for preterm and low birth weight, this vaccine can be given as soon as the child is stable. There is no weight criteria. So next we'll move on to DPT. So DPT contains diphtheria, pertussis and tetanus. Diphtheria toxoid is around 20 to 30 low flow units. And pertussis, it can be a whole cell killed pertussis or it can be a acellular component. So that, based on that, we call it DTWP or DTAP. And tetanus toxoid, composition is 5 to 25 low flow unit is there. And you have another preparation called TDAP, capital T, others are small. So in that you have 5 lossless unit of tetanus and less of diphtheria toxoid, 2.5 units. So generally it is a liquid preparation. It has to be stored at 2 to 8 degree. It should never be frozen. We all know the tea vaccines are never to be frozen. And by chance, if it has been frozen, it has to be discarded. And it is given as 0.5 ml deep IM in anterolateral aspect of the thigh. Generally, the effectiveness against diphtheria and tetanus is around 95%. Around for pertussis, the whole cell vaccine has a efficacy of effectiveness of around 78%. The adverse events are the main things which are very much talked about in DPT. So the minor adverse events, namely the fever, local pain and swelling, occurs in almost half of the children who are vaccinated with DPT. But more severe ones like persistent crying occurs in 4 to 8 out of 1000. Hypoxic hyporesponsive episode occurs in 0.06 to 0.8 per 1000, that is less than 1 per 1000. Seizures occur in 0.16 to 0.39 of 1000. And encephalopathy is very, very rare. It occurs almost 7 in a million. Okay. But what are the contraindications for DPT vaccination? The absolute contraindications are anaphylaxis or encephalopathy within 7 days following DPT vaccination before. The relative contraindication is progressive or evolving neurological illness. Persistent inconsolable crying more than 3 hours, hyperpyrexia, hypoxic hyporesponsive episodes, seizure with or without fever within 32 hours, all these are precautions and not contraindication. If a child is going to have any of these, it doesn't mean the next dose should not be given. Maybe the child has to be observed following the next dose. We have to be more cautious with the child rather than saying don't give the vaccine for one child. So what is the schedule? It is given as 3 doses. Currently, it is a part of pentavalent vaccine and it is given at 6, 10 and 14 weeks. And you give 2 boosters, first one at 15 to 18 months and second at 5 years. Then you give Tdap or Td at 10 years. What I mean is, as per the IAP schedule, you have to give Tdap at 10 years. But as per the national schedule, you give TD. Tdap is not infiltrated into the national immunization program. So as a national program, we give TD at 10 years. But as a practitioner, for office practice, it is ideal to give Tdap rather than TD. And this is to be followed by TD at 16 years and then TD every 10 years. For pregnant antenatal mothers, we generally do for primies, we give Tdap or TD at registration and TD second dose of TD after 1 month. If the mother is going to be a second order pregnancy or above, or if even a primary is fully immunized, you have the her card, then one dose of Tdap or TD will suffice. Here again, the Tdap is being advised by the IAP, but still in national schedule, we are giving TD rather than Tdap. So next we are going to see certain things about the polio vaccine. So as far as the disease is concerned, last case of polio was reported in India in 2011. As of now, as of today, only Pakistan and Afghanistan are the only 2 countries who are still reporting polio cases. This acute flaccid paralysis program is being designed to screen all the children under 15 years of age. And this is in order to improve the case detection of polio. So in this program, the subtle indicator is that you generally non-polio AFP occur at a rate of 2 per 1 lakh. So you should be reporting for 1 lakh population at least 2 AFP cases. So that is the indicator that the program is functioning well. We had elaborate discussion about acute flaccid paralysis yesterday. So I'm just touching upon this and not elaborating. So oral polio vaccine, you have 2 kinds of vaccines for polio, oral and injectable. So oral polio vaccine is a live virus vaccine. You have several formulations, monovalent, bivalent and trivalent. So trivalent containing all the OPV strains, all the polio virus strains 1, 2 and 3 was used in the national program till April 2016. From April 2016, we have switched over from trivalent to bivalent OPV, which contains only polio virus types 1 and 3. 2 has been removed. Because the last case of wild poliovirus 2 occurred only in 1999 and in the world. So almost wild polio virus 2 has not been there around for more than 15 years. And we want to decrease the cases of CVDPV2 and VAP. So we have eliminated the wild polio virus 2 from the oral vaccination, and we are giving only bivalent OPV. Generally, it is stored frozen, and it can be stored in 2 to 8 degrees for around 6 months. And it is given as 2 drops or 0.1 ml orally. So everyone has to know about this vaccine vial monitor. This is a very frequently asked question in the exam. So there are 4 stages of vaccine vial monitor. This is because this polio virus is very thermolabile. This vaccine vial monitor is very, very important. It tells about whether the vaccine has been exposed to heat and vaccine has been inactivated or become ineffective due to the heat. So these are the 4 stages of EVM. In the first stage, the central square will be in white color and the surrounding round will be in bluish gray color. So if this is how your medium shows in your vaccine vial and the expiry date has not passed, then you can use the vaccine. In stage 2, the inner square will not be white in color. It will become slightly gray, but still it will be lighter than the outer ring. In that case also, if the expiry date has not been passed, we can use the vaccine. In third stage, the inner square and the outer circle will be of same color. It will merge. So in that case, you should not use the vaccine even if the expiry date has not been passed. And stage 4 is where the inner square is darker than the outer ring. Here again, you should not use the vaccine. So injectable poliovirus is made from selected wild poliovirus strains. It is grown in vero cell culture or human diploid culture, inactivated with formaldehyde. It should be refrigerated and not frozen, unlike your OPV. It is given in intramuscular dose as 0.5 ml. And it can also be used in intradermal dose, that is called fractionated IPV. When we use it intradermally, it is required at 1/5 of the dose. 0.1 ml of the preparation is given intradermally, whereas 0.5 ml if it is to be given intramuscularly. It is also available as combination with other vaccines. So what is the schedule which is being followed? You need to understand that both OPV and IPV are currently advocated for any child. So as regard to OPV, as I already said, we give bivalent OPV, which contains 1 and 3 strains and not the 2 strain, which has been removed. And the just OPV will not suffice because this OPV does not contain the poliovirus 2. So to have protection against poliovirus 2, you have to use IPV, which contains all the 3 strains. 1, 2, and 3. So we are using this IPV not as a primary vaccination, but as for risk mitigation. So you have to give either two types of schedules can be followed. Either you have to give 1 dose of intramuscular IPV of 0.5 ml or 2 doses of fractional IPV. So what is being followed in our status? We give bivalent OPV, 0 dose at birth. Then at 6 weeks, we give bivalent OPV and fractional IPV intradermally. Then 10 weeks, you give bivalent OPV. Then 14 weeks, again, you give bivalent OPV and fractional IPV intradermally. And the booster, which is given at 1.5 years, you give bivalent, either both can be given. You can give either bivalent OPV or you can give IPV as booster. So either of this can be given depending on the availability. And what are national immunization days? This is a newer name for pulse polio program. So this here, in this program, all children less than 5 years are given OPV vaccine. This is generally done during the lower polio transmission season. The examiners might ask you every year, when was this national immunization day this year? So you should be able to remember that and tell that. So next, coming to rotavirus vaccines, there are many preparations of rotavirus vaccines available in the market. Monovalent rotavirus vaccine is called Rotarix, and the pentavalent is called Rotatec, and our Indian indigenous 116E vaccine is called Rotavac, which is the one which is being used in the government programs. Then your bovine reassortant one, which is called Rotasil, which is manufactured by Serum Institute, is again an Indian preparation. Rotarix is given in 2 doses. All the other vaccines are given in 3 doses. And the volume varies between vaccines. Like a Rotarix is given as 1 ml, Rotatec is 2 ml, Rotavac is 0.5 ml, and Rotasil is 2.5 ml. All these are oral vaccines. So how do you give? You give 3 doses at 6, 10 and 14 weeks. And the maximum age limit for your pentavalent and monovalent rotavirus vaccines are first dose should be given less than 15 weeks. And for any dose, all the doses should be completed by 8 months. But for Rotavac, in our government policy, it can be given to any child who is lesser than 1 year of age. That is the upper limit for the first dose. So Rotavac has been introduced from 2016 in many districts. In certain states, around 11 states are giving Rotavac vaccine as of now. It is available as a 5-dose vial, and each dose is 5 drops or 0.5 ml. The vaccine is generally pink in color. It can be used for 4 hours after opening. It is stored in 2 to 8 degree along with the BCG. This is also thermolabile, so it has a vaccine vial monitor. We can see that the efficacy against severe rotavirus gastroenteritis is maximum for the monovalent and pentavalent preparation, which is around 90%, which are international preparations and which are available in our private market. The Rotavac, which is being used in the government sector, it has got an efficacy of 54% against severe rotaviral gastroenteritis, whereas for Rotasil, it is still lesser. Whenever we think of rotavirus vaccine, the next point immediately which is very much debated is the risk of intussusception. As per the Global Committee for Vaccine Safety 2017, they say that there is a small but definite but small risk of intussusception following the use of rotavirus vaccine, but benefits outweigh the risk. This is a statement made by the Vaccine Safety Committee 2017, Global Vaccine Safety Committee. But there has been a recent study by rotavirus, after this Rotavac has been rolled out in the 11 states I have told you, there is a post-marketing surveillance or rotavirus impact surveillance done by ICMR. And this study has been published in your in one of the issues of Vaccine Journal in 2020. Their surveillance was done across 35 centers in 3 states, Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra and Himachal. And they found that there is no increased risk of intussusception within 21 days after the receipt of any dose of any of the 3 doses of Rotavac. So we need not worry about the risk of intussusception when it comes to our Rotavac, which is being followed. Then lastly, we'll just see the few things about pneumococcal vaccine. So you have 2 types of pneumococcal vaccine again. You have a conjugate vaccine, you have a polysaccharide vaccine. Conjugate vaccine, you have a heptavalent, you have a 10-valent, 13-valent. And these are all basically conjugated vaccines. So they induce a T-cell dependent immunity. They can be used in children less than 2 years. Efficacy of the 10 valent is found to be 64%, whereas the 13 valent has clearly higher margin of efficacy, more than 11% more than the PCV10. So PCV13 is preferred in your office practice. And how do you schedule the PCV? As per IAP, you have to give 3 doses at 6, 10, 14 weeks and a booster at 12 to 15 months. This is the ideal schedule which is to be followed for the office practice. But as per national schedule, this PCV has been introduced in selected districts of some 5 states. So to start with, it was in 3 states, then 2 more states were added. So as per this schedule, they are giving 2 doses of PCV at 6 and 14 weeks and then a booster at 9 months. So this is being followed in 5 states. And as far as another issue is, this invasive pneumococcal disease is more relevant for VLBW infants who are more prone for this invasive pneumococcal disease. So they are the ones who need it the most. So as a part of National Health Mission, the National Health Mission has been supplying pneumococcal vaccine for at-risk, that is the VLBW infants, on follow-up. And they have been vaccinated with at 6, 10 and 14 weeks with pneumococcal vaccine. You have a pneumococcal polysaccharide vaccine, which is a 23 valent vaccine. It is T cell independent and it is poorly immunogenic in children less than 2 years old. And the immunological memory is also low and there is no herd immunity. But what are the indications of this vaccine? It is given in immunocompetent with congenital heart disease, particularly the ones with cyanotic heart disease and CCF, then respiratory conditions like asthma, then conditions like diabetes mellitus, and wherever you have a CSF leak. Then in children with anatomic and functional asplenia, like in sickle cell and other hemoglobinopathies where you have functional asplenia. Then in children who are going to undergo cochlear implant, and in immunocompromised children, either due to HIV or due to CKD or nephrotic on steroids, or any child with any hematological malignancy on anti-cancer drugs. In all those children, this pneumococcal polysaccharide vaccine is given. But it is not given alone. It is not used as a standalone drug. You give pneumococcal conjugated vaccine followed by your polysaccharide vaccine. So after the last dose of PCV, you give 8 weeks after the last dose of PCV, you give the polysaccharide vaccine. So with that, we come to the end of this brief presentation about the vaccines. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sridevi. One excellent one. I think we can invite for the next talk by the case discussion with Suranjan and
yes,
Satish and